Yeah, it needs to.
Next, we'd like to go ahead and introduce Craig Riegelbrook. He is the Senior Vice President of American Hort, and this is the national trade organization representing the entire horticulture industry. Riegelbrook serves in national leadership positions representing the horticulture industry on matters relating to the labor force, plant health, and trade. He co-chairs the Agriculture Coalition for Immigration Reform and is on the board of the National Immigration Forum's America is Better. He also serves as Immigration Committee Chairman for the National Council of Agricultural Employers.
Thanks very much, and please call me Craig. It's way, way, way simpler. Good morning, folks. It's great to be with you today. And those of you who are offsite in Prosser and Vancouver out in God's country, I'll let you fight over which that happens to be. I think I drew the short straw today, and so I get to try to explain the madness that is going on with respect to our labor situation. This is an issue that, I mean, it's near and dear to me and my own industry organization. Way back in about 1996, we looked around at all the different issues that were affecting the ability of our members to succeed, to grow their businesses, to pass them along to the next generation. And of everything that challenges our people, labor rose to the top. And we've been deep in the trenches trying to work on solutions, some wins here and there, some big setbacks. But what I'm here to do today is just kind of walk you through what we see as both opportunities and, in a few cases, threats in the present tense. Because at the end of the day, we can't do what we do without water and sunshine, and we certainly can't do what we do as horticulturists and growers and whatnot without labor. So I'm going to share a few facts. I think it's helpful for folks to have a little bit of grounding about what are we really talking about. But then I especially want to dive in. I think we actually have an interesting federal legislative opportunity right before us as we speak. That'll be unfolding in the coming months, and also some other potential ways that we see some progress on the issue. So I'll talk about legislation, potential rule changes affecting H2A, and then just a bit of an outlook. So for starters, it's complicated to figure out how many farm workers there really are in the country. There is not a single extremely reliable data source. USDA usually reports that we have somewhere around 1.1 million full-time equivalents. But we all know that in most aspects of agriculture, there's a lot of seasonality, and the labor force gets stacked up in these peak seasons. For you, it's, you know, probably the big peak season is in the July, August, varies depending on crop and where you are. But we know it takes more bodies to do the work than there are full-time equivalents. This has been extensively studied in California, and I would suggest your ag is not all that different from California's. They're number one in the nation in terms of how much labor it takes to get the job done, and you're number two, those of you who are operating in Washington State. So the analysis in California has shown a 2-to-1 ratio, so that for every full-time equivalent job, there are actually two hired farm workers. It used to be a higher number, but we are deploying the workforce more efficiently. And so I would suspect that 2-to-1 ratio is fairly accurate nationally, which brings us into the range of 2 to 2.5 million total folks hired each year is what it takes to get the job done. Now, there are some things changing, and we look to a survey called the National Ag Worker Survey to try to understand what's going on in this space. And what tends to happen in that survey is they take multiple years of data together, and we can compare them sort of over time. So the numbers I'm going to share here with you real quickly are looking at basically data from around 2009 and around 2016. One of the things we're seeing is that farm workers directly hired, that number is going down. Correspondingly, the farm workers that are being provided through the use of a third-party labor intermediary, like a farm labor contractor, that's going up. 12% of labor was provided that way in 2009, and it's grown to 20% as of 2016. And I would submit to you, based on the explosion in farm labor contracting that's going on with the H2A program, that number is already substantially higher than that. We're seeing the workforce gain experience. It used to be that we had a lot of folks who were recent arrivals, came across the border to work in ag, and didn't necessarily stay very long. But we now actually have a situation where the average years of farm experience has gone up to 14. And again, it's probably even crept higher than that since that's a 2016 number. And the workforce is aging in place and it is vulnerable to attrition. Whether attrition means they get a better job, they age out, they go back to wherever home might have been. We're tremendously vulnerable to the current workforce, non-H2A, being lost to attrition as they age. 24% held a non-farm job in the last 12 months, which basically means that people often are supplementing in the down seasons on the farm by working elsewhere. 76% say they plan to stay in ag at least 5 years or as long as they can. Not surprisingly, the majority of the workforce is from Mexico, about 70%. 25% is U.S. born, meaning United States or Puerto Rico, and then the bulk of the remaining 7% comes from Central American countries. If I forget to say it later, I'll say it now. Things are changing in the sending regions from which we have derived most of our farm labor over many years, namely Mexico. Things are changing. The Mexican economy, it continues to diversify and improve. I mean, it's fits and starts. The Mexican birth rate has fallen to where it's just above our own birth rate, and so they're barely above replenishment level. And we are already beginning in the big ag production areas in Mexico to hear stories about labor shortages and workers being brought up from Central America. So I think it's going to behoove us in the H2A context to really seek to diversify the relationships that we have with countries beyond Mexico, even though for at least another generation, Mexico is going to remain exceptionally important for the labor that it provides. Employment eligibility, this is, are you legally here? Are you legally present and legally authorized to work in the United States? 51% in these surveys say yes, which essentially means half of the workforce, probably north of a million people, are not legally present. They have documents that appear genuine. The employer has usually done their due diligence, filled out the I-9 form, et cetera, but if the music stopped and the documents were thoroughly checked, a lot of them are likely to be fraudulent. This is obviously a shaky foundation on which to build a successful and thriving industry, and it's something that we frankly have to deal with. Three quarters of the farm workers here that are foreign born have been in the United States at least 10 years, and that number has been steadily climbing up. Migrancy, this is really no surprise, but the phenomenon of migrancy, which used to be a big deal, California up, Florida up the East Coast, Florida up, Florida and Texas up into the upper Midwest like Michigan. Migrancy used to be a big deal and it has diminished and it is soon going to be a thing of the past. Why? Because people have settled. They put down roots, they've had children, they've wanted a more stable lifestyle, and so migrancy is rare. From a demographics and family composition, the majority, more than two-thirds, are males, although in many aspects of ag, we're seeing a lot more women. We're seeing a real increase in the women that are doing a lot of the work. Average age 38, and that's just creeping up. 14%, and remember, this is 2016, 14% were 55 and older. 57% were married, 55% had children. Many of those children, practically speaking, they were born here and they're considered U.S. citizens under our law. Lots of mixed status families where maybe one partner has legal status, another doesn't. There's a child that was brought here and another child that was born here. So it's a very, very complicated situation. And it's going to take a little bit of careful thought to solve it in a way that makes business and economic sense, that makes national security sense, and at the end of the day, that makes humanitarian sense. There is, in my humble opinion, and I'm not going to preach to you today, but there is a moral dimension to solving this issue wisely, because we are talking about human beings who have hopes and dreams and aspirations and fears and everything just like the rest of us. H2A growth is exploding. This is a complicated chart, but the one piece you need to see is that year-to-date column position certified down near the bottom. For the fiscal year that just ended, at the end of September, the Labor Department certified 257,667 positions to be filled by a foreign worker coming in through the H-2A program. Last year, it was 240. For many years, up until the Great Recession, H2A tended to provide in the range of 50 to 60 or 65,000 positions per year. So the program is growing exponentially, even though it is difficult, bureaucratic, and obviously very expensive. So we're seeing year-on-year double-digit growth, and that's been going on ever since the Great Recession sort of wound down. Washington State used to not even be a player on the list. You're now number three on the list in terms of employment of workers who are here on a temporary and seasonal basis on H-2A visas. Florida's one, Georgia's two, you're number three, and California has crept up to number four, and Washington and California will probably soon be numbers one and two if current trends continue. Top crops, the biggest single share is remaining crops, and the blues there are general farm workers or just kind of the catch-all miscellaneous. But the single largest category where there's a specific crop identified is berries, not surprisingly. We've seen such a tremendous growth in the berry industry in this country and corresponding growth in H2A because berry production tends to be so labor intensive. Okay, so jumping over, that's enough about the numbers, but jumping over to, is there any reason to be hopeful that the situation gets better in the relatively near future? And just for clarity, I'm going to keep referring to this. We've got two potential paths to real progress in the foreseeable future. One of them is a legislative path. The other is an administrative or rule change path. So one of them takes Congress, always uncertain, never easy, very unpredictable. There are always more reasons to doubt that Congress will get something done than there are to be optimistic about it. But I'm gonna tell you where we see the opportunity and how it unfolds. Then the other path, it depends on the Trump administration following through on an initiative to make H2A more approachable for farmers. Obviously, Washington, I'm beating my head against the wall every day there, and I've been doing this work for 30 years now, and I've never seen the situation as polarized and as gridlocked as it is now. And we have to deal with a changing political situation, the one we're confronted with right now. As I'm sure you know, if you're paying any attention to the news, the House of Representatives is controlled by the Democrats, the Senate's controlled by the Republicans. But despite all that, there's a little bit to talk about here. So in terms of the political context, as we've been trying to get legislation teed up this year, there's a couple things you should understand. Number one, it's important that the House gets something done first. Why is that? If you look back over the last 15 years or so, the United States Senate has actually passed broad-based immigration reform bills that have included a special title dealing squarely with agriculture. Back in 2006, they passed a bill. In 2007, they came close. In 2013, they passed another bill. And each time, the House of Representatives has sat on the sidelines and kind of thumbed its nose at the whole process. And so the Senate's not going to take this issue up and waste all the time and energy and take the political heat unless there is some sense that the House is going to do something. So they're waiting on the House to act. And with Democrats controlling the House, that basically means we're stuck with a situation where it's going to be a challenge to get what we, from a grower perspective, believe ought to be in a bill. House leadership will not move a bill unless the farm worker advocates are behind it. So, I mean, that's just the political reality. So we have to, even though somebody in the room might say, why are you talking to the United Farm Workers? They hardly represent anybody. They don't deserve nearly the influence they have. The bottom line is Speaker Nancy Pelosi will not move a bill forward if the UFW opposes it. That's just the blunt reality that we have to deal with. So as stakeholder groups, we're employer advocates and we're talking across the table with worker advocates. When you start to parse the issue and what do we need to have happen here? Well, we want a better visa program and we want solutions for the current workforce. Well, the current workforce solutions, that's the easy place to find common ground. The UFW shares the same concerns that we do. When it comes down to guest workers, it's a much rockier path. And so I think it's fair to say the legislation that's taken shape I think it does a good job on the current workforce piece, and there still is some work that we'd like to see achieved as the legislative process moves forward on the visa program. And some of the flashpoints in the visa program, it's how do you set wages? Are there caps on how many visas can be provided? If so, how are those caps set? What are the workers' enforcement rights? And I'm standing before you, we're not going to drill down into what's going on out here in the Evergreen State, but I'm well aware. I actually was listening to two attorneys yesterday talking about the tales of woe with fights over prevailing wage surveys, with various other fights. It's a very supercharged atmosphere out here, particularly in Western Washington, with respect to ag labor, very polarized and very, very difficult. And we as an industry, I think, are going to have to figure out somehow how to get to a better place with respect to public perception and public understanding, and to be able to wear a, you know, sort of a white hat on this whole labor relations situation. But anyway, that's kind of the political backdrop in which all this goes on. So the take-home message is, with respect to the House of Representatives, number one, by its definition, anytime there's a compromise, it means everybody had to give up on things they wanted. So nobody's completely happy. Nature of the beast. A frustration is, in these negotiations, the UFW has more influence in the democratically controlled House than they will have as the process moves forward. Republican-controlled Senate, Republican-controlled White House. So they've been unwilling to put all their cards on the table and really negotiate to what we would see as a true and fair bottom line. That's going to have to come later as these other force, you know, as a bill advances. So that made the House negotiation just that much more difficult. We are not fully bound to this deal. I mean, if this package I'm about to talk about in detail gets through the House, we have the right to try to improve it in the Senate, and we will do so. And we've identified several key areas to try to improve it. Now, in terms of what's happening in the House, there is a bill. It's called the Farm Workforce Modernization Act, H.R. 5038. It's been months in the negotiating process, started back in April. And there are a lot of members of Congress involved, but the ones that really deserve the most attention, the two on the left are Democrats. Zoe Lofgren is from the San Jose area in California. She chairs the House Judiciary Subcommittee on Immigration and Citizenship. So this is her wheelhouse. She's the woman who kind of is in charge of what are we going to do on immigration policy. And she has stated that dealing with agriculture is a high priority for her. Below her, that's Jimmy Panetta. Folks probably remember Leon Panetta was around politics most of his life. Jimmy is son of Leon and is in Congress. The three on the right are Republicans. I would hope you know the gentleman with the beard, Dan Newhouse. Dan Newhouse has been exceptional in this process. He has been thoughtful. He has been measured. He has been tenacious. I can stand up here, and I'm not being paid to say this, I can stand up here and tell you, you have a real thoughtful, caring agricultural advocate in Congressman Dan Newhouse. I first met him some years ago. We had a blizzard going on in Washington, D.C., and he was stranded there along with a bunch of other people. He was ag director at the time, and there was an ag commissioner's, secretary's, director's meeting. And because we were all snowed in and couldn't do anything else, I got to know him well talking about this issue. And I kind of see it as his destiny to be in the center of the effort to get this done, in part because the last time the House of Representatives actually did something generally helpful on this issue, it was all the way back in 1986 when Ronald Reagan was president. And the lead Republican in the House at that time was a guy named Sid Morrison, who was from Washington State, from the same district. So it's kind of a little bit of history repeating. That's what I'm banking on here. Mario Diaz-Balart from Florida in the center, and then Mike Simpson from Southern Idaho. Idaho, last I looked, pretty red state. It's kind of a gutsy thing to be out there on the leading edge trying to move an immigration bill, but Mike Simpson's just kind of tired of it. He's kind of fed up. He's fed up with how long this issue's dragged on. He's got a huge dairy industry, probably number three in the nation. And when ICE goes in and audits a dairy, what they tend to find is upwards of 90% of the workers don't have good papers. So the engine in the Southern Idaho economy is absolutely dependent on immigrant labor. And Mike Simpson knows it, and he wants to fix the problem. The bill as it stands right now has 53 co-sponsors. And in these times of all this crazy polarization, folks, it's pretty amazing that we have 25 Republicans from around the country, pretty diverse bunch, who are willing to put their name on a bill like this and say, I'm for this. It's harder to do that than just to say, if it comes to the floor, I'll vote for it. But I don't want to put my head up because I'm going to get the anti-immigrant movement is going to attack me or whatever. But we have 25 so far and counting Republicans who have said, I'm going to put my name on this. The bill takes a three-pronged approach. It has Title I deals with current workforce stabilization. Title II makes some changes to H-2A. They're mostly helpful. And then Title III would phase in the mandatory electronic employment eligibility verification program known as E-Verify after the other reforms have had a chance to take effect. I saw a head shaking, so I'm going to make a further comment on that when we get to the slide. From a status standpoint, this legislation passed the House Judiciary Committee, which was the critical first step, on the 21st of November. So it's ready to go to the floor. It might happen in December. There's a crowded calendar, only a couple of weeks before they recess for Christmas. And if you've been watching the news at all, there's this other sort of little distraction going on the side. But we're hopeful it can get to the floor in December, or if not in December, in January. The Senate will do something different. There are already members stepping up saying, I want to work on an ag bill in the Senate. It won't look quite the same as the House bill, but those conversations are already starting. I'm going to go into a bit more detail. I've provided more on the slides, and your eyes are going to glaze over this. I told folks down at the National Council of Ag Employers yesterday, this is the fun stuff. If you like watching latex paint dry when the humidity is up really high, you're going to like this a lot. But we got to kind of unpack this thing and make sure you understand what's in it. So for current workforce, Title I, three options. One, if folks are kind of trapped here out of status and they simply want to transition into H-2A, that becomes legally possible. I don't think that's going to appeal to a lot of people, but it might to some, and that's the easy option. The second two options are built around them coming forward and becoming a certified agricultural worker, which is kind of a provisional or conditional immigration status. And they would either be able to simply get that provisional status and then renew it every 5 years, or for those who aspire to become permanent residents, there is a pathway that would allow them to pursue that. It would take a lot of time and they'd have other hurdles to jump, but it is possible. So certified ag worker, basically workers have to prove that they are experienced ag workers, that they did at least 180 days of ag work in the past 2 years. The status would provide them work authorization for 5.5 years, protection of family, right to work and travel, and they would essentially be covered by the same domestic labor laws that you and I are. As I already mentioned, this status could be renewed at the end of 5 years. It could be renewed twice or three times, and then maybe somebody goes back home or whatever they decide to do. It's kind of important just to point out, this is a detail point, but for those of you in H-2A who are vulnerable to having to hire domestic worker referrals that are sent to you by your ever-loving state workforce agency, there is some the shielding to the extent you have experienced workers who are returning. You do not have to hire one of these certified ag workers as a domestic worker who would displace your H-2A worker. That was seen as a matter of fairness by a lot of us. Chance to optionally pursue permanent residency. The path depends on how long you can prove you've been here working in ag. For people who can prove that they've been contributing in the sector for at least 10 years, they would have a 4-year ag work commitment to qualify. For those who meet the minimum but can't prove 10 years, they would have an 8-year sort of path to qualify. Background checks, penalties, lots of little details that we don't have the time to go into on that one. Title II, modernizing H-2A, a couple things I want to call out here. A lot of the focus is on streamlining and simplifying the platform so that there's a single application portal and the agencies that each have a piece. There's some clarification of what their responsibilities are and aren't, so we get rid of some of the duplication. We've also, frankly, limited the role that the state workforce agencies can play in this program because we're seeing more and more challenges where state workforce agencies are throwing up barriers that are preventing people from using what's supposed to be the consistent federal safety net. There are some cost improvements. They are not as major as we would like them. The underlying visa that's provided would have a 3-year life, even though the worker's only here typically 10 months or less working. And so the fact that the visa doesn't expire when they come back the next year, that saves the employer some money in years 2 and 3. The elimination of any requirement to do newspaper advertising is a cost savings for employers. There's some other regulatory relief. I think one of the most helpful pieces is this bullet on staggered entry, where right now, if you need 100 workers, but you don't need them all on day one, staggered entry is the concept that you can bring them in as you need them. Under current practice, if you're bringing them in groups like that, you actually have to file separate applications. Under this improvement, in a 120-day window, you can bulk up your workforce as you need it. Wages, this has been an extremely tough issue, and I think one that Washington State is really the canary in the coal mine on wages getting to levels that are unsustainable in a globally competitive agricultural ecosystem. It retains a lot of the basic current structure. You still have to pay the higher of federal or state minimum wage, prevailing wage, the so-called adverse effect wage with some changes. Or if there's a collective bargaining agreement, the collective bargaining wage. The relief comes in, there is a 1-year freeze on the AWER, so that would be immediate relief and helpful for pretty much everybody. And then beyond that, the methodology by which the AWER is determined each year doesn't fundamentally change, at least for 10 years, but there are caps put on how much the wage can go up or down in any given year. Because you're in a high minimum wage state where the distance between the minimum and the AWER may get kind of close, it may be that you're ultimately subject to the annual cap on increase being 4.25%. For most of the country, it'll be 3.25%. This falls far short of what we would like to see in the way of reform. But again, I explained up front the negotiating environment and the leverage points. So this has been a very difficult area in the negotiation, and it's an area, it's the number one area for further improvement if legislation advances through the process. One thing that's helpful in some parts of the country, once the job is posted, so the recruitment begins, if the wage changes, if a new AWER comes out after that happens, you only have to pay what you promised. You don't have to increase your wages. One of the most troublesome things, and frankly, to be blunt, we can thank the Trump administration for doing this to us in a way, in their regulatory proposal. They proposed disaggregating where instead of a single adverse effect wage that generally applies to all the workers, that there would be separate wages published for us for a whole bunch of different occupation categories: crop workers, livestock workers, graders, sorters, and packers, equipment operators, first line supervisors, and potentially some more. And each one of these categories would have its own wage, and you would have to pay the highest applicable wage if you have a worker that's working across two or more of those areas. We're very concerned about that. And because the Trump regulatory proposal proposed it, this was jammed down our throats, in essence. Basically, call it what it is, the worker advocates and the Democrats who were carrying their water telling us, we need to include this because the Trump administration's proposed this, and we want to acknowledge their role in this whole debate. This is an area that needs fixing, regardless of how we move forward. The good news is, after 10 years, there is an opportunity to get rid of the AWER as we know it, but there's not an absolute guarantee of that. Still maintains the requirement to provide housing. There are some financial incentives that can come back to employers, as well as a bulking up of the low interest loan programs that exist to fund the rehabilitation or construction of new farm worker housing. There also is, and I'm not sure if this is a big issue for you all, but there also is the establishment of a new category in H-2A that would allow you to have a year-round job filled by an H-2A worker who can be here continuously performing that job for up to 3 years. that does not exist in current law. So the bad news is this portion of the program is capped at 20,000 visas per year. Half those visas are restricted for use by the dairy industry, the other half by all the rest of agriculture. Because it's a three-year visa, do the math, 20,000 year one, 20,000 year two. By year three, you climb up to 60,000. But those numbers are lower than what we would like to ultimately see. On the other hand, there remains no cap on the current H-2A temporary and seasonal up to 10 months piece. No cap at all on that piece. This is a totally new thing. We frankly just don't have a lot of friends in terms of an uncapped program that we can fill year-round jobs with. But this is helpful. The cap can rise after those first 3 years, and then after 10 years, there will be an assessment of whether a cap is needed at all, and if so, how it's dealt with. A couple other features of the bill I want to mention briefly. Congressman Newhouse felt very strongly about this. He wanted to try to have a portable visa, meaning a worker can move among job opportunities at will, much the way we can. And so there's a six-year pilot program that would allow up to 10,000 workers to have a portable visa. He believes that this might be more flexible for smaller growers who need a cohort of labor for a limited amount of time. That's kind of where he's coming from on that. There are also, in the bill, 40,000 new slots where employers can sponsor for permanent immigration a foreign worker if they have a job, a year-round job that they cannot fill with an American worker. Under current law, this is extremely difficult to do. There are very few numbers provided, and the bill would provide, again, 40,000 green card slots for employer sponsorship, and ag gets first preference for those 40,000 visas. Our primary concerns, I've kind of touched on this, but our primary concerns with where the bill falls short on H-2A, the wages, it still relies on surveys. We'd like to get out of that business. There are too many classifications and the highest applicable wage having to be paid to a worker that works across more than one. This is top priority to change. We need to have some clarity that you're paying based on the primary job done, and that if there are some ancillary or lesser limited tasks around the side, that doesn't change the required wage. And then the current statute that applies to the domestic workforce generally, the Migrant and Seasonal Ag Worker Protection Act, would be expanded to H-2A workers. That is something that we vehemently oppose, but it is in the package. The concern obviously is about having to go to court, about expansion of private rights of action to seek redress in the courts. The good news in the package, mediation is required, and many times mediation of disputes can resolve them short of going to court. And I think the rest of the reality is we're all asking our own members, how much exposure is really created here? That there is some, undoubtedly, but for an employer who has some domestic workers and some H-2A workers, they're probably already subject to MSPA. The additional burden is not all that great. We don't like it. We'd like to strip it, but that's where we are. And then to the slide that that my friend right in front of me that's dressed to go to Seattle this afternoon, on E-Verify, we're agnostic on whether E-Verify is good policy or not. There is tremendous support, particularly among Republicans, to make electronic verification using the E-Verify system mandatory. What the bill does, it makes some general improvements to try to deal with fraud that happens within the E-Verify program, some of the weaknesses of the current program, but then it would be phased in specific to agriculture after these other reforms have had a chance to be implemented. It would phase in large employers to small employers, so starting with 500 or larger and eventually down to the smallest employers. It would only apply to new hires. It would not apply to current workforce, which is consistent with current law. I think some of the Republican support that we're seeing on the bill is reflective of the fact that the enforcement piece is in there. It gives them some cover to say, I want to help ag, but I also want to bring integrity to the hiring process. There are plenty of folks who think E-Verify is terrible. I mean, there are people who take libertarian views. There are people who are worried about it for other reasons. But I'm just telling you kind of what is and the dynamics around it. Okay, I'm going to shift over. A couple of things still we need to say. I want to talk just for a couple of moments about the Trump administration's efforts to improve H-2A in the regulatory process. And this really all took root back in April of 2017 when the president met with Ag Secretary Sonny Perdue and a group of about 15 farmers. And their issues, it's like their number one issue was labor. Their number two issue was labor. And their number three issue was labor. They also talked about trade, which is a big deal, and regulatory reform. But out of that meeting grew the commitment to try to run an interagency process, USDA, DOL, Homeland Security, and others, and sort of figure out what changes could be made to make H-2A more reliable. Now, I have to tell you, the farmers that came out of this meeting, they really enjoyed their conversation with the president. One of them was a member of mine, so I heard it firsthand. And it just had me thinking, you know, President Trump has remained very, very popular in rural America, very popular in farm country, even though one might argue that some of the policies that we're currently living under are not particularly beneficial. Particularly, I mean, the trade chaos that's going on, the end game, you know, we're all still hoping the end game's good, but very, very painful. And we're seeing increases in parts of the country in farm bankruptcies, largely because of that. Anyway, I say all this, but the popularity remains rock solid. And I've just been trying to understand that, not judge it, but just understand it. And I finally think I have figured out what the driver for this is. It's like this visceral connection that people have because there's a familiarity. And I think at the end of the day, it's corn. It's when they see his hair, it's like, yeah, it's corn. So now you know the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey used to say. I'm not going to go into tons of detail on this. The reforms that the administration's proposed, in many cases, parallel the reforms that are in the House bill. Process streamlining, getting rid of the requirement to do advertising, allowing for staggered entry of workers. So there is some good in it. There are also some real challenges. I already mentioned wages. The Trump proposed rule gave us the wage structure that we're now fighting to get out of the House bill. They've ignored the pleas. We believe they could be more flexible on the length of season and on how temporary and seasonal are dealt with. We believe they could expand the definition of agriculture somewhat to give more people access to the program. There's this thing called corresponding employment, where if you have to pay your H-2A workers the adverse effect wage, anybody domestic in your operation doing at least one job in common, you got to pay them that too. They've missed an opportunity to improve and clarify that. So it's a real mixed bag. I'd like to think that the comments that we all filed before the comment period closed at the end of September will cause the agencies to go back and get it right, and that we'll see a final rule in March that gets it right, but we don't yet know that. I think the fact that this rule wasn't more helpful reflects that internally in the Trump administration, there is tremendous tension over this issue, tremendous tension. We have on one hand people like Ag Secretary Sonny Perdue who really want to help us. And we've had some White House advisors over time. I think Jared and Ivanka, if we could sit down across the table with Jared and Ivanka, problem solved. But the other force that is very well entrenched in the White House and clearly has the president's ear to a very significant degree, we'll call it the Stephen Miller wing, very, very dim view. I mean, they basically want to keep the foreigners out, and they don't quite frankly care what the context is, whether it's permanent immigration, whether it's temporary visa programs. And so I think the administration is really struggling to be as pro-employer as we might hope it to be on this issue because of the populist arguments around protecting U.S. workers from the competition of foreign workers. I think we all understand if we get this right, we have such great strategic advantages in specialty crop, high value agricultural production that we can take advantage of in this country. We can do so much, but if we don't have a functioning labor program, it's going to drag us down. And so I'm hopeful that the cooler heads prevail, but we're not there yet. Sort of summing up, number one, I mean, we really need legislative reform. The rulemaking stuff could help us a little bit, and I am optimistic that before the sun sets on 2020, I almost said on 2019, before the sun sets on 2020, I am cautiously optimistic we will see some improvements We will have something to celebrate as progress on this difficult issue. But we ultimately need legislation because rule changes can't fix everything that's messed up about the existing visa program. If you're looking at the situation, you're saying, how can you even be the least bit optimistic that Congress will do something? Here's the biggest reason why I am. We have this program called the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals that was established in the Obama administration. And there are somewhere on the order of 800,000 people who have received protection from deportation under that program. There is tremendous public sympathy and tremendous political sympathy for the so-called Dreamers who have were brought here no fault of their own, have grown up here, are American by every right, in many cases don't know the countries really that they came from. In June, we are expecting a Supreme Court decision on whether the Obama administration exceeded its executive authority in establishing the DACA program. And court watchers seem to be generally of a mind that the court will strike it down. If that happens, I believe it will be the strongest possible catalyst that we'll see to create an imperative for Congress to do something. And if we're poised, if we've moved a bill through the House, if we've built a consensus in the Senate, maybe, you know, a legislative product, even if it hasn't passed, the imperative to do something on DACA, I think there will be a significant opportunity for us, whether it comes during the summer or whether it comes post-election, to move ag as part of a somewhat larger package. And in the meantime, you know, we as an industry, there's no easy answers here. I know you're all struggling with the same things we are, but it's all about worker retention. It's all about improving jobs and working conditions as much as we possibly can, recognizing the limits that Mother Nature places upon us. H-2A use is going to continue to grow, whether that's direct employer or whether it's in the context of using a third-party intermediary like a farm labor contractor. I think there's going to be a lot of scrutiny on farm labor contractors, so you really need to know that if you're using an H-2A LC, you need to know that they are placing a high premium on integrity in recruitment that's happening in the sending countries, as well as on regulatory compliance here. Otherwise, you'll be very, very vulnerable. And then finally, mechanization, automation, labor-saving innovation. There's tons of opportunity out there. It's all expensive, long-term work. The easy stuff was done years ago. But learning to be more efficient and more automated and whatnot is going to clearly be part of the solution as well. Last slide, if nothing else happens, I mean, the first thing we have to look forward to, we're going to have new 2020 AWERS formally announced in just a couple of weeks. The national average increase that's teed up based on the data is 5.6%. Most states see increases well over what they would see if the House bill I described was already law. In Washington and Oregon, you're looking at going up to 1583, 5.3% increase. Very, very difficult in the competitive economic conditions that we're in to do that. And then we're likely to see continued worksite enforcement, more and more pressure, which contributes to attrition of this very valuable and really essential resource that we have in terms of the current workforce that is not properly authorized to work in the United States. Chris, I probably used every last minute of my time, but if there is a chance to take a question or two, I'm absolutely more than happy, or an editorial comment. Just don't throw anything. Yes, sir.
There we go. All right. Who really sets the price, which is high, for the H-2A people? And is it the government or is there contractors that's doing it? It's kind of, we had a kind of a strange happening here a year or so ago where they're sending sick people up here to, and then the sick people want to claim that to be taking care of their health.
So what I'm not going to address here today is the calculation of prevailing wage based on local wage surveys. And I know there's been some major drama here in the state with your state workforce agency establishing what they're claiming to be the prevailing piece wages, in, for example, in some crop areas, and not wanting to reveal their methodologies. I mean, it's been an ugly situation, and we have to make sure that integrity, you know, if there is a local wage survey that results in a wage, it has to meet the federal standards that are established for those surveys. And it's very, very clear to me that what they've done in Washington State sometimes has not. On the federal level, these aren't fictitious numbers. USDA surveys agricultural employers all around the country, basically asking how much have you paid your workers? And they publish a result as a result of that average wages. Well, the challenge is the average wages, it's the mean average, which basically means you're taking a number of different jobs. You're taking people who are entry level. You're taking people who are 20 years of experience. You're taking highly skilled, you know, butters and grafters. You're taking equipment operators. In the plain states, where a lot of the agricultural employment is operating combines that are moving up and down the Great Plains harvesting grain crops, they're living in an ecosystem where when the oil boom was going on, somebody who can operate a combine can probably be sucked into the oil patch to be an equipment operator there. And so their wages were going through the roof because of that competition. But these surveys, I mean, I think the surveys themselves have integrity. It's not that USDA doesn't know how to do a survey. It's that the result of that survey that is then being imposed as the minimum wage for the following year for everybody in agriculture that's using H-2A, it's the methodology, what the Labor Department does with the numbers is what the problem is. Now, I have heard in Washington State that, for example, in apples, most of the big guys are already in H-2A. They've had to. Some of the smaller operators have been resisting it because you've got housing costs, you've got all these other program costs that they're trying to avoid. And so the word on the street is that some of the smaller operators are bidding their wages up higher than the adverse effect wage, not a little bit higher, to retain labor and to avoid all of these other program costs. And then guess what? Those are the people that get surveyed the next year. So in a sense, it's the non-H2A people that are jacking up the wage for the following year. Now, I'm not looking to point fingers, but I'm just saying all this stuff figures into, and we ultimately need to get to a more rational system than making last year's average wage next year's minimum wage. It's kind of like Garrison Keillor. It's kind of like Lake Wobegon. You know, nobody can be below average. It's an insane way to establish a wage structure in an industry that is in global competition, to be clear.
Just for my own observation, the only thing that's going to straighten out this whole mess between whether it's between politics or the whole ball of wax is, and or even religion, is we need a pretty heavy recession that brings everybody back to their shoes, back to the old school mentality.
Yeah, I share some of your view. And one thing that we need to figure out how to do as a nation, you know, we have organized our society at this point where everybody clumps with people that think and look like them. And at the end of the day, we've got to figure out how to have a conversation with people that have different views without it turning into a fight. Like Thanksgiving, I don't know about you, but politics at the Thanksgiving dinner table, just to be avoided. But we need to figure out how to get back to being able to have a reason, a dialogue where there's an exchange of thought and opinion that is constructively focused rather than destructive. And we're not there right now. One more question, anyone? If not, I would simply say thank you. I hope you've learned a little something. And keep the dream alive. We got to get this thing solved. Thanks.
Thanks, Craig. We can go ahead and take a break now for lunch, and we'll be back for our next sessions at 1:30.